أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله بارئ الخلائق الأجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء حبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين لا سيما ولي الله الحجة ابن الحسن صاحب الأمر والزمان اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من الأولين والآخرين إلى قيام يوم الدين صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب الغرباء يا مظلوم كربلاء السلام على من جعل الله الشفاء في تربته السلام على من الإجابة تحت قبته السلام على ساكن كربلاء فيا ليتنا ثم يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي يا سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أما بعد قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه الحكيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما أرسلنا من قبلك إلا رجالا نوحي إليهم فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون صدق الله العلي العظيم وآمنا به نوروا مجالسكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد The Quran is that divine book of guidance and that constitution through which if a person was to implement it, he is able to seek perfection and to seek happiness and prosperity both in the dunya as well as in the akhirah. And therefore it is important for us to study the Quran as this divine book of revelation. Having said that, you find that dhikr is a central part of a mu'min's life. It is important for a mu'min to always be in a state of dhikr. And traditionally, we define dhikr, or we restrict dhikr to be the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is confined generally to tasbih or to other phrases such as alhamdulillah and subhanallah and wala hawla wala quwwata illa billah. Any phrase which is attributed towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which gains or helps you or is a wasila that reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is generally given the term dhikr. If we were to review and we were to try to understand the concept of dhikr from the Quran as per the Quranic definition, you will find that there are close to 17 different definitions of the term dhikr which is mentioned inside of the Quran. Insha'Allah, tonight we shall try and discuss at least 6 of these different aspects of, or the 6 different dimensions of dhikr, which is mentioned within the Quran, and through this, inshallah, we are able to broaden our understanding. The first concept which is defined as dhikr, or the first definition of dhikr which is mentioned within the Quran, is that of salat. In that, salat is sometimes mentioned as a dhikr within the Quran. You come to Surah Al-Hud, for example, verse 114. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Quran, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Wa aqimis salati tarafay an-nahar wa zulfan min al-layl innal hasanati yudhibna as-sayyi'at dhalika dhikra lidh-dhakirin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and establish the prayer on the two turns of the day. Two turns of the day, yani the initial point where the sun is beginning to rise, the first break of dawn, Salatul Fajr, and the second turn of the day is when the sun, upon rising, when it reaches Zawal at its peak and it becomes a descent, the second turn of the day, the time for Salatain al-Dhuhrain, wa zulfan min al-layl. For you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, establish the prayer during the beginning parts of the night. For you find between the brackets through this verse of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes 5 prayers through 3 basic timings. In that you have the tarafay al-nahar, and then you have zulfa min al-layl. Establish the prayer on the two sides of the day and during the night. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, indeed the performance of good deeds wipes away the bad deeds. ذَلِكَ ذِكْرَى لِلذَّاكِرِينَ. This establishing salat is a dhikr for those who remember. And therefore we understand through this verse of the Quran that the first dimension of dhikr, or the first definition of dhikr, is that includes salat. And you find that salat as an establishment has been granted great importance within the deen. You will find that Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, in his wasiyah to his sons Imamain, Sayyidi Shabab Ahlil Jannah, he says to them, Allah, Allah fi salat. And then you have another tradition by the 6th Imam where he goes on to say, Imtahinu shi'atina inda thalatha. The 6th Imam says, if you want to test our Shia, you want to test a person whether he is truthful in his claim when being a Shia. We have number of people, thousands if not hundreds of thousands of people who claim to be the Shia of Ali Muhammad. How do you know who is truthful and who is not truthful? Imam al-Sadiq tells us, if you want to distinguish between the one who is truthful in his claim to being a Shia from the one who is not truthful, examine them during 3 things, or examine them in 3 things. One of them, the Imam says, Imtahinu shi'atina inda thalatha. Examine them during 3 things. Inda mawaqit as-salat, ahum muhafidhuna alayha. The Imam says, if you want to recognize a true Shia, examine them during the time of salat. See during the time of Salat, are they establishing the prayer? Are they reciting the prayer or not? If you find them at the awwal waqt in the form of Salat, in the state of Salat, you know that they are truthful in their claim. Do you have another hadith from the sixth Imam where he goes on to say, لا ينال شفاعتي or لا ينال شفاعتنا من استخف بالصلاة. The Imam says, the one who downplays the importance of Salat shall not seek our intercession. Therefore, you find that within the spirit of the Quran, the first definition or the first dimension of dhikr is Salat. Number two, the second dimension of dhikr which is mentioned in the Quran is dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Muzammil says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, وَذْكُرِ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ وَتَبَتَّلْ عَلَيْهِ تَبْتِيلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remember the name of your Lord, increase the remembrance of your Lord, وَتَبَتَّلْ عَلَيْهِ تَبْتِيلًا, and disconnect yourself from everything in the world and direct your attention towards Him. In the tafsir of this ayah, our seventh Imam Musa al-Qadim, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, he states that tabattul, over here he was asked, what is the meaning of tabattul? The Imam says, tabattul, meaning an tukallib kaffayk in the dua, idha da'awta. Imam al-Qadim says that the meaning of tabattul in this verse, that when you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you uphold His memory through dua and you seek and you beseech Him for your hajat, whether they are of the dunya or the akhirah, you raise your hands towards Him. And therefore you find that one of the sifat of the followers of Ahlul Bayt is that whenever they raise their hands in kunut, they raise their hands like this. Whenever you are reciting dua of any sort, you raise your hands like this. Why does a person raise his hands in this manner? This raising your hands with your palms facing towards the sky is a symbol of an establishment of your relationship with your Lord, in that I am nothing but a despicable slave and beggar, and Allah is the giver of everything, the creator of everything within the universe. Therefore, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Therefore, through the institution of dua, you are establishing this concept which is firmly rooted in your heart, that you are nothing but a slave, and that everything we have, we are nothing but beggars. Everything that we have and everything that we aspire to have is in the hands of Allah. And hence you find his ism from the Asma'ul Husna is that he is Ghani, the one who gives whoever he wills. Therefore, you find that within the spirit of the Quran, the first definition of the word dhikr is that it is a reference to salat. The second definition of dhikr is that it points towards the concept of dua. The third concept of dhikr, or the third definition of dhikr, which is mentioned in the Quran, is that of shukr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu idhkuru ni'mati alaykum. O you who believe, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, remember and recount all the ni'mas and the bounties that I have bestowed upon you. There, how do we recount? How do we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the bounties that He has bestowed upon us, regardless of whether it is our health and our wealth and our children and our security, our financial ability and status, everything that we have? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do shukr. How do we do shukr? There are a number of manners through which shukr can be performed, depending on the time of the ni'mah. But one common way of performing shukr is through sajda to shukr. In Wasa'ilu Shia, Kitab Wasa'ilu Shia, the sixth Imam narrates, Man sajada sajda to shukr lillah wa huwa mutawaddi' كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ عَشْرَ صَلَوَاتٍ وَمَحَى عَنْهُ عَشْرَ خَطِيئَاتٍ عِظَامٍ وَرَفَعَ لَهُ عَشْرَ دَرَجَاتٍ. The sixth Imam al-Sadiq goes on to say, for a person who performs sajda to shukr after performing wudu, to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the bounties that he has, for this simple token of gratitude, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him with 10 different blessings and forgives him 10 major sins that he has committed. It takes ahibai one sin, major sin, from the great sins for a person to enter into the burning flames of Jahannam wal-ayadu billah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives 10 of these when a person does sajda to shukr and raises him 10 levels higher in Jannah. For you find that the third concept of dhikr is that of shukr. And you find that shukr, in regards to the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ni'mah or the bounties of Allah are divided into two. You have ni'mah which is maddi, and then you have ni'mah which is ma'nawi. You have those blessings or those ni'mahs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which are materialistic. Our wealth, our houses, our cars, our family, our social statuses, our security, our freedom, everything doing in terms of materialistic bounties from Allah. This is known as the ni'mah or ni'am maddi. And then you have a different type of ni'mah, which is ma'nawi, the spiritual bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which He bestows upon a person. What is the greatest spiritual bounty, ni'mah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us? You find this again within the Quran. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu idhkuru ni'matallahi alaykum. Remember the ni'mah and thank Allah for the ni'mah that He has bounted upon you. Which is the greatest spiritual ni'mah that Allah has bestowed upon us? Again, you find it in Suratul Ma'idah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَذِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. Mufassireen of the Quran, whether they are from the school of the Ahle Shia or from outside the Ahle Shia, are unanimous on the fact that this verse of the Quran was revealed on the day of Eidul Ghadir, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed Amirul Mu'mineen as the Khalifa and the Wasi of Rasulullah. This wilaya of Amirul Mu'mineen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes it as a ni'mah in the Quran. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati, ya'ani Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib is the ni'matullah al-kubra. Allahu Akbar. This love that we have for Amirul Mu'mineen deserves shukr. How do we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us a master and a leader like Amirul Mu'mineen? This, inshallah, we shall discuss in the nights to come. Do not take this love for granted. See, a person came once to Imam al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salam. And he says to him, he comes to the Imam in Medina. He says to him, Yabna Rasulullah, I am overcome with poverty. I am not able to cater for my family. I am not able to cater for myself. Neither do I have barakah in my business. I am drowning in poverty. I am poor. I need help. Imam, can you help me, Yabna Rasulullah? Imam al-Sadiq looks at him and he smiles. He says, enter, you are not poor. He says, Ajib. Ya Ibn Rasulullah, The signs of hunger are apparent on my face, and I am complaining to you that I am not able to feed my family. Wajib shar'i for me to provide for my wife and my children. And you are telling me I'm not poor? The Imam says to him, yes. And he smiles. He says, why? How? Explain to me. Ibn Rasulullah. Imam As-Sadiq tells him, do you have the love for Amirul Mu'mineen in your heart? He says, yes. He says, if I was to ask you to sell this love of Amirul Mu'mineen for 100 dinars, would you sell it? He said, no. He said, if I was to give you 1,000 dinars and ask you to compromise or to give away this love of Amirul Mu'mineen, would you give? No. Imam goes on to say, if I gave you 1,000,000, yani alf, if I was to give you 1,000,000 dirhams, would you give away this love of Amirul Mu'mineen? He says, never. Until I die, I would never give away this love of Amirul Mu'mineen. Imam As-Sadiq tells him, then you are not poor. You have something which is greater than what the wealth in the entire dunya can buy. And that is the wilaya of Amirul Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Therefore, this love of Amirul Mu'mineen and this affiliation in that our identity revolves around him is something that we need to take pride in and a ni'mah which we need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. Therefore, coming back to our kalam, you find that the first concept of dhikr is that it is defined as salat. The second dimension of dhikr is dua. The third dimension of dhikr, which is mentioned in the Quran, is shukr. The fourth concept of dhikr, which is mentioned within the Quran, is that of tabligh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to the Holy Prophet, and he says to him, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, فَذَكِّرْ إِن نَفَعَتِ الذِّكْرَ. Call the people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, this calling and this preaching shall be beneficial for them. For you find that in this verse of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word dhikr, remembrance, for tabligh. Why? Because in essence, Rasulullah is inviting man towards that fundamental belief in the existence of one God, this fundamental belief which everybody is initially born with. These values of good nature, these values, common global ethical values, which they call them right now, which we are born with which our fitrah invites us towards, Rasulullah is calling us towards these primary values. And these values over time have been eroded or have been corrupted because of the effect of the dunya on a person. His engagement with this dunya, his preoccupation with seeking wealth, distracts him from that which he was initially originally created for. For you find that Rasulullah is coming to invite man back to the path of fitrah. He is inviting them towards that oath, that mithaq which they took in Alam al-Dhar. Hence you find for this reason, tabligh over here is referred to as dhikr from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, you find that the fourth definition of dhikr within the Quran is tabligh. Tayyib. Till here, we have seen that all these four dimensions of dhikr which are mentioned in the Quran are related to acts of worship. Tabligh is an act of worship, salat is an act of worship, dua is an act of worship, and similarly shukr is an act of worship. However, if you continue to research within the Quran, you will find that the concept of dhikr is not only restricted to acts of worship. However, you find that many times even the Quran, within the Quran, is described as being a dhikr. You find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Hadha dhikrun mubarakun anzalnah. Afa antum lahu munkirun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala
tells the Holy Prophet to address the people from Mecca by saying to them that this Quran is a dhikr, which is Mubarak. By implementing the teachings of the Quran, by following the verses of the Quran, you find you gain barakah in your lives. This book, which is a book of logic, this book which calls you towards truth, this book which liberates you from all the chains and all the shackles of meaningless culture, this book of freedom is a book of barakah. Why do you oppose this book? For you find that in addition to the four acts of worship which are used as dhikr within the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also refers to the Quran as dhikr. Therefore, you find so far how many dimensions of dhikr have we seen from the Quran? Five. The sixth dimension of dhikr, in that dhikr is not only, the concept of dhikr is not only restricted to acts of worship or to a book such as the Quran, but it is applicable on people as well. A person can also be a dhikr. How? Proof from the Quran itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Rasulullah as a dhikr. You find in Surah Al-Talaq, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Kad anzalallahu ilaykum dhikra. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed or has sent for you a dhikr. Who is this dhikr or what is this dhikr? The verse continues. Kad anzalallahu ilaykum dhikra rasulan ilaykum. This dhikr is a rasul. Which rasul? Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Rasulan. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ بَيِّنَاتٍ لِيُخْرِجَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. Allah says that we have sent to you this dhikr. Who is the dhikr? Rasulullah. Who invites you with the clearest signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for those who believe and perform good deeds, He removes them from the darkness of ignorance and deviation and misguidance and invites them towards the light, the nur of Tawheed. For you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Rasulullah as a dhikr. Yani the dhikr of Rasulullah is the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In essence, one of the titles of Rasulullah is that Rasulullah is dhikrullah. Tayyib. If we understand this, we push the argument a little bit forward. Is there any other personalities or are there any other personalities whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created other than Rasulullah, who are also referred to as dhikr within the Quran? You come to Surah An-Nahl, verse number 43. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ. We did not send before you, Ya Rasulullah, any other person except that we sent upon them revelation, we inspired them with revelation. Yani all the 123,999 prophets before Rasulullah, you, Ya Rasulullah, each and every one of them was divinely inspired and appointed by Allah. And then the verse goes on to say, فَاسْأَلُوا أَحْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask. This now is a command. فَاسْأَلُوا. The Quran is talking towards who? Is talking to who? The Quran is talking to the entire humanity. So Allah is telling humanity, فَاسْأَلُوا أَحْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of dhikr, ahlal dhikr. Ask the people of the dhikr for issues which you do not know. Whenever you come across an issue which you do not understand, regardless of whether it has to do with ideology or not, Allah is commanding us to return back to a point of reference, a group of people known as the Ahl al-Dhikr. Now Allah is telling us that you need to refer back to a group of individuals known as the Ahl al-Dhikr. Who are these Ahl al-Dhikr? I need to be able to identify them. So in order to identify them, I say to myself logically that if I am to refer back to an authority who is able to explain to me and to teach me those matters of the deen and the dunya which I do not know, he has to be the most knowledgeable. And if it is in matters of the deen, I have to ask somebody who has understood the deen in the best way, who has implemented the deen in the best way. A person who has understood the deen in the best way and who implements himself the deen in the best way and can teach the deen in the best way. In short, he has to be ma'soom. He has to be infallible. So then I ask myself, is there a group of individuals within the Quran who have been identified as infallible people? I come to the verse of Tathir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Innama yuridullahu liyudhiba ankumu rijsa ahlal bayt wa yutahhirakum tathira. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. You refer back to the mufassirin of the Quran from the Ahli Shia and the mufassirin of the Quran from the Ahli Sunnah. You find that there is ijma on the fact that the five people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala endorses with infallibility is none other than Rasulullah, Amirul Mu'mineen, Sayyid al-Zahra, Imam Hassan and Imam al-Hussein. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. You find scholars of the greatest caliber from the Ahli Sunnah, the likes of Jalaluddin Suyuti in his tafsir, Fakhrul Razi, Sahih Muslim on his commentary in regards to this verse, Tabari in his tafsir, go on to state that the five people who are under that kisa, under that cloak, when this verse was revealed, was none other than this five. For you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces the Ahlul Bayt in the Quran as being Ahlul Dhikr. People of Dhikr. To do the Dhikr of Ahlul Bayt is to do the Dhikr of Allah. And from amongst these Ahlul Bayt, there is Sayyid al-Shuhada, for which there is a particular proof. See, we said that from the verse within the Quran, Surah At-Talaq, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Rasulullah as being a dhikr. Ya'ani Rasulullah is dhikrullah. Sahih. If we understand this, you find the hadith. Hadith which is narrated by scholars from the Ahl Sunnah. Refer back to Sahih Tirmidhi. Refer back to Ibn Majah. All of them state that Rasulullah said, Hussein minni wa ana min al-Hussein. Ahabba Allahu man ahabba Husayna. Rasulullah says that Hussein is from me. Hussein minni. Hussein is from me and I am from Hussein. Allah loves the person who loves Hussein. In the Quran, Allah is saying that Rasulullah is dhikrullah. And Rasulullah then goes on to say that Hussein is from me. Yani, if Rasulullah is dhikrullah and Hussein is from Rasulullah, yani Hussein is also dhikrullah. The dhikr of Imam al-Hussein is the dhikr of Allah. The dhikr of Imam al-Hussein is the dhikr of Rasulullah. The dhikr of Rasulullah is the dhikr of Allah. Therefore, this majalis Imam al-Hussein is a form of dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what the enemies of Ahlul Bayt from the Nawasib have totally missed. This hatred and this enmity towards the majalis of Sayyid al-Shuhada, terming it to be a bid'ah, actually reflect their lack of understanding of the Quran in itself.
According to the Quran, the dhikr of Imam al-Hussein is the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which we have established right now. Therefore, ahibai, do not take light, do not downplay the importance of participating in these majalis of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Majlis Imam al-Hussein is dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam al-Sadiq salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. He states in his hadith, Nafasul mahmum lana tasbih wa hammun lana ibadah. Imam al-Sadiq says, every breath that you take while you are in a state of grief for us is tasbih in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anta janabak, while you are sitting in this majlis and your heart is overcome with pain and grief over the martyrdom of Sayyid al-Shuhada, you find that for every breath that you take, the malaika are writing for you tasbih. Shi adhim jaddan. These are the nights of Muharram, the greatest nights in the year. And it is these months or these nights in the year, Shahrum Muharram, where the purpose of our existence is fulfilled. Rasulullah tells Sayyid al-Zahra that they shall come a generation. Allah will create generation after generation a group of people who shall mourn for Sayyid al-Shuhada. That generation is you and me. We are that foretold or that prophesied generation that shall ensure the dhikr of Imam al-Hussein remains alive. And we need to welcome these months and enter these months with the right frame of mind. You find that it was on a night like this, the first of Muharram. Today, millions of people, hundreds of thousands, if not a million in themselves, who gathered together in Karbala al-Muqaddas to witness the changing of the flag over the blessed Qubba of Imam al-Hussein and Mawlana Abil Fadl al-Abbas. Thousands of people shouting out, Labbaika Ya Hussein. Thousands of people renewing their pledge and renewing their allegiance with Imam al-Hussein. The first goal of Shahrul Muharram and the nights of Shahrul Muharram is that we renew our allegiance towards Sayyid al-Shuhada and to uphold the grief and the aza over him. When you come and you weep for Imam al-Hussein, you are seeking the direct attention of the master of Jannah. Imam al-Sadiq in his hadith, he tells one of his companions by the name of Ibn Bukair, Abdullah ibn Bukair, hadith in Kamil al-Ziyarat. He says that Imam al-Hussein, Sayyid al-Shuhada, from the top of the arsh, looks at each and every person who weeps for him. وَهُوَ يَنْظُرْ إِلَى مَنْ يَبْكِي عَلَيْهِ وَيَسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُ وَيَسْأَلْ أَبَاهُ أَنْ يَسْتَغْفِرُ لَهُ. To paraphrase the hadith, the sixth Imam says that when you shed a tear over Imam al-Hussein, this Imam stands watching from on top of the arsh, seeks forgiveness for you. Adhim jiddan. He asks his fathers, yani Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sayyid al-Zahra, to ask forgiveness for you and me. Aslan, who am I for Sayyid al-Zahra to even look at me? This is the barakat through Imam al-Hussein. And you know, every year when Shahrum Muharram comes in, this first night, which I'm told is very commonly known over here as Chandrat. Do you know what is the significance of this Chandrat? This first night of Muharram? Do not think it's a coincidence that once Shahrum Muharram comes in, isn't it strange, yani ajib? Isn't it strange that as soon as the first night of Muharram comes in, you find that your heart is filled with grief and pain? And you don't know why that this grief is overcoming you. This is not a coincidence. There is something special about this Chandrat. What is it? Hadith of Imam al-Sadiq. He says, إِذَا حَلَّ حُلُولِ شَهْرِ رَمَضَانِ نَشَرَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ قَمِيسَ الْحُسَيْنِ. Imam al-Sadiq says that as soon as the night of Shahrum Muharram comes in, as soon as the crescent, the first eve of Shahrum Muharram comes in, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the angels to fly across the skies with the shirt of Imam al-Hussein. Imam al-Sadiq then goes on to explain and describe the shirt, and he says, وَهُوَ مُخَذَّبٌ بِدَمِهِ. This shirt of Imam al-Hussein is filled with his blood. The malaika are weeping for Imam al-Hussein. Enta Habibi, you are not the only one weeping for Imam al-Hussein. The entire kaun, everything within the realm of existence is weeping for Imam al-Hussein. Imam al-Sadiq goes on to say, Lamma madha inna Aba Abdullah al-Hussein Lamma madha bakat alayhi samawat sab wal arduna sab wa ma fihinna wa ma alayhinna وَمَنْ يَتَكَلَّ وَمَا بَيْنَهُنَّ وَمَا يَتَكَلَّبْ عَلَيْهِنَّ وَالْجِنُّ وَالنَّارِ وَكُلْ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهِ مَا يُرَى وَمَا لَا يُرَى. Imam al-Sadiq says that the heavens weep for Imam al-Hussein, the earth weeps for Imam al-Hussein, everything within the earth and the heaven weeps for Imam, the jinn weep for Imam, the fire weeps for Imam, the animals, the fish in the sea all weep for Imam al-Hussein. Imam al-Sadiq says, what you can see with your eyes, what cannot be seen with the eye weeps for Imam al-Hussein. The entire kaun on a night like this is crying out, Ya Hussein. And therefore it is our responsibility to uphold these majalis and this dhikr in the best manner and in the most passionate manner possible. And we begin this dhikr, or we begin these blessed nights by remembering the aza and the masaib of Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra. Allah, Allah, Ya Zahra. This masaib is a moment captured by a poet, a conversation that takes place between Imam al-Hussein, Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra, and the Rasulullah. Allah, Allah. The poem says, the poet goes on to say, on the night of Laylatul Wahshah, yani Shame Ghariba, when the soul of Imam al-Hussein, when the ruh of Imam al-Hussein was raised up towards the heavens, Imam al-Hussein meets with his mother Fatima al-Zahra and his grandfather Rasulullah. Allah, Allah. Now this is a majlis aza which is taking place in Jannatul Firdaus, in the highest levels of Jannah. These three are having this conversation. Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra turns towards her father Rasulullah. She says, Abata, Abata, Ya Rasulullah. Oh my father Rasulullah, if only you were there in the dunya to see how the ummah treated me after you departed. Al-Jib. What did they do to you, Sayyida Zahra? She says, oh my father Rasulullah, after you left us from the dunya, your companions came and they burnt down my house seeking bay'ah from Amir al-Mu'mineen. She says, "Oh father, I was choking from behind the door due to the smoking flames as they sought the bay'ah from Amir al-Mu'minin." Rasulullah begins to cry. At this point, Imam al-Hussein stands up and he says, "Oh my grandfather Rasulullah, just like the way they burnt the house of my mother, just like the way they burnt the house of my mother, they also burnt our tents in Karbala." He says, "Oh my grandfather Rasulullah, my sister Zainab and Umma Kulthum, my wife Rubab, my daughter Sukaina and Rukaya had to run out into the desert due to the burning tent." Allah, Allah. The narrator and poet goes on to mention that Rasulullah is crying for the masaib of Sayyidah Zahra and the masaib of Imam al-Hussein. Sayyidah Zahra then goes on to say, "Oh my father Rasulullah, they did not stop over here, Allah. They didn't only burn down my house. What else did they do to you, Ya Zahra?" She goes on to say, "Oh my father, after they burnt down my house, this la'in came towards me and he kicked me on the side of my stomach, making Mohsin Shaheed. This infant who was in my stomach, who you had named Mohsin, became Shaheed due to this kick." Allah, Allah, Rasulullah begins to weep. At this time, Imam al-Hussein says, "Oh my grandfather Rasulullah, just like the way my brother Mohsin was Shaheed, I also had an infant in Karbala. Being thirsty for 3 days, they pierced him with an arrow from one part of the jugular vein to the other." The narration says at this point, Rasulullah begins to hit his face and his head out of grief. Sayyidah Zahra stands up. She says, "But the masaib is not finished. What else?" Allah, Allah. Sayyidah Zahra turns around and she says to Rasulullah, "Oh my father, Rasulullah, they crushed me between the door and the wall, breaking my rib." Zahra says, "Ya Rasulullah, they attacked me in such a manner that my rib was broken." At this point, Imam al-Hussein stands up and he says, "Oh my mother Zahra, for the one rib that was broken of yours in Medina, come to Karbala, come and see how they trampled upon my body, breaking every rib in my body." إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون ولعنة الله على أعداء آل محمد من الأولين والآخرين إلى قيام يوم الدين. ماتم حسين.